This hearing on Americans detained in Iran will come to order. I'm going to ask all of the members to take their seat at this time. All four of our witnesses are close relatives of these Americans who've been away from their families now for far too long. Ali Rezaian is the brother of Washington Post correspondent Jason Rezaian, whose so-called trial began last week. That is a trial that began in secret. Nagma Abedini is the wife of Pastor Saeed Abedini. Sarah Hekmati is the sister of former U.S. Marine Amir Hekmati. And Daniel Levinson is the son of Robert Levinson. We deeply appreciate, I will say to all of the family members here, you being with us today to give this testimony today. The committee stands in solidarity with each of your families. We can't imagine what you're being put through. We share your anger, we share your frustration with the position that you've been put in. Immediately after our hearing today, the committee will be passing a resolution that calls for Iran to release all detained U.S. citizens immediately and provide information it possesses regarding any who have disappeared within its borders. And I'd like to recognize the work of Congressman Huffman of California, Congressman Labrador of Idaho, and Congressman Kildee of Michigan. And of course, Mr. Deutsch is a senior member of this committee. And I know that these members have worked to represent the best interests of your families, and I thank each of them for joining us here on the committee today. This morning, we will be hearing the stories of these four Americans. Jason Rezaian is a journalist who was born and raised in California. He hoped to use his position at the Washington Post to present a greater understanding of the Iranian people. Arrested on trumped-up charges, he's been interrogated. He's been held for over 300 days at the infamous Evin prison. Like every other aspect of his case, his trial opened last week, shrouded in secrecy. In September 2012, Iran arrested and later sentenced Pastor Saeed Abedini to 8 years for gathering with others to study the Bible. As his wife notes, this is a lawful act, even under Iranian law, but one which the regime deemed a threat to national security. His jailers have asked him to renounce his faith, and I think he's been jailed for 8 years with threat of more if he does not renounce his faith. In August 2011, Amir Hekmati, a former U.S. Marine, was sentenced to death for alleged espionage. Upon his appeal, the sentence was reduced to 10 years. His sister will tell us how Amir has been treated on his feet with cables and tasered repeatedly in the kidneys. His father is gravely ill, and he had gone to Iran to visit family. In 2007, Robert Levinson went missing on Iran's Kish Island. 8 years later, Iran continues to refuse to assist the United States in locating him. As Daniel notes, his father is the longest held hostage in American history. Each of these tragic cases is unique, but they each demonstrate Iran's view of the United States, which is one of contempt. Washington Post editor Martin Barron wrote last week, "There is no justice in this system, not an ounce of it. Iran is making a statement about its values in the disgraceful treatment of our colleague." This is, by the way, I would point out, a country that regularly holds these Death to America rallies. And so the contempt with which they hold American hostages is not something new with respect to dealing with the Iranian regime. And frankly, with the Houthis now holding four Americans and refusing to release them because they're Americans, we have an extension of this policy into Yemen. And while our focus this morning is the release of these Americans, these cases do call into question the integrity of the diplomacy surrounding Iran's nuclear program. As editorial boards point out, is this another attempt to pressure the administration into weakening its position at the talks. If a journalist can be suddenly imprisoned on bogus charges, what treatment can international inspectors for Iran's nuclear program expect? And I would add to this a more fundamental point. If top Iranian officials cannot be counted on to assist these wrongfully jailed Americans, can they be counted on to honor the commitments they make at the negotiating table? Call me a skeptic, but we are very concerned about the fact that these four Americans have been held for so long, and especially this show trial, which just began last week. So the bottom line this morning is that these four Americans should be allowed to come home now. And I will recognize the ranking member for today's hearing, Mr. Ted Deutsch of Florida, for any opening comments he may have.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thanks to you and Mr. Engel for giving us the opportunity to hear from the families today. Let me say to each of you today, we will not rest until your brothers, fathers, and husbands return home. I represent South Florida, Coral Springs, Florida, especially today, home to the Levinson family. Bob Levinson disappeared from Kish Island in March of 2007. Since his disappearance, Bob's family has received proof of life in the form of pictures and recording, yet Bob's whereabouts remain unknown. No family should have to go through 8 agonizing years of not knowing when their husband, father, and grandfather will come home. In those 8 years, Bob has missed his 7 children's birthdays and weddings, his 40th wedding anniversary with his courageous wife, Christine, who is here today, and the birth of grandchildren. In a 2013 CNN interview shortly after his election, President Rouhani said, "With respect to Bob, we are willing to help, and all the intelligence services in the region can come together to gather information about him to find his whereabouts, and we're willing to cooperate on that. It is well past time to make good on that pledge." For the next 30 days, U.S. negotiators will sit across the table from their Iranian counterparts. I appreciate the efforts made to raise these cases at every meeting, but the time has come to turn up the pressure. We've been told for a variety of reasons why the nuclear issue should be dealt with separately. But where we are now and at this morning's hearing is not about centrifuges, it's not about enrichment capacity, PMD, or snapback sanctions. It's about respect for human rights and human dignity, and it's about justice. The United States government must not rest until Amir Hekmati, Jason Rezaian, Saeed Abedini, and my constituent Bob Levinson are home. And the time, Mr. Chairman, is now. I would now ask unanimous consent to yield 1 minute to the gentleman from Michigan, Mr. Kildee, who is the author of the resolution that we'll be marking up after this hearing, calling for the release of these individuals in Iran. He also represents the Hekmati family.
Without objection. Mr. Kildee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for holding this hearing and taking up this resolution, and thank you, Ranking Member Deutsch, for your help and your perseverance on this question. We're here today to hear testimony from families whose loved ones are imprisoned in Iran, including my constituent, Amir Hekmati. It's important that we hear their stories. It's important that the American people hear the names, Amir Hekmati, Jason Rezaian, Saeed Abedini, Bob Levinson, and not let their cases or their stories fade. Congress should know their names. The American people should know their names. They're being unjustly held in Iran, and they should be released so they can be with these family members. The world is watching Iran, and today Congress and this committee will speak with one voice, considering House Resolution 233, that calls on Iran to simply do one thing, release the Americans that it holds. It's very simple. It states, this resolution states, and this Congress will say with one voice, that Iran cannot hold Americans as political prisoners, people like Amir Hekmati, if it wants to be taken seriously in the global community. Let me be clear, the onus is on Iran to do what is right, to release Amir and the other Americans that it holds. So to the families today, I look forward to hearing your testimony, to hearing your stories, to help the American people and this Congress understand that each of these individuals deserve the rights and the respect that any human being does. And I look forward to the day when we can welcome them all home. With that, Mr. Chairman, thank you so much, and I yield back.
Mr. Chairman, I now ask unanimous consent to yield 1 minute to the gentleman from California, Mr. Huffman, who represents the Rezaian family.
Without objection.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to thank you for the opportunity to be here to welcome my constituent, Ali Rezaian, and to express my solidarity with him and his family and all of the families here and the many people around the world who are watching this important hearing today. It's important that we do speak with one voice today, especially given the fact that there is a spectacle of a trial taking place in Iran involving Jason Rezaian. It's important that the Iranian regime understand that the whole world is watching, and our bipartisan expression by passing this important piece of legislation is one of the best ways we can make that statement. I want to thank my colleague Dan Kildee for his leadership in authoring this bipartisan bill, and I want to thank the committee for considering the bill on its own merits. Whatever issues or even disagreements we may have about broader issues, we are able to speak with one voice on this important matter today, and that is important for all of these Americans who are unjustly detained and for their families and supporters around the world. Thank you very much.
And thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back now to my time.
Thank you, Mr. Deutsch. Without objection, I think I'll also recognize Mr. Raul Labrador from Idaho for a minute, if you'd like to comment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for letting me speak, even though I'm not a member of the committee. And NAGMA, welcome to our committee today and to Congress. Not only is she a constituent and her husband a constituent, but she's a dear friend of many of my dear friends who love her and who I hear from almost on a daily basis about your husband. On December 20th of 2012, Reverend Saeed Abedini, a naturalized U.S. citizen and convert to Christianity born in Iran, was imprisoned on charges of undermining national security for setting up orphanages in partnership with Iranian Christians. His close trial was held January 22, 2013, and he was convicted and sentenced to 8 years in prison. I commend President Obama for advocating for the release of your husband, and I know that he has spoken to Iran's president on this, but I also believe that I am concerned that the Iranian government is more interested in words than in actions. If the Iranian government is sincerely committed to action, a good first step would be to immediately release your husband and all the other people that are being held captive in Iran. And I believe that all negotiations with Iran should cease, in my opinion, if this is not the first step that they engage in. If they're not willing to become part of the world community, we should not be negotiating with them at all. And I hope that this hearing today will help us to get that goal completed. Thank you very much for being here, and God bless all of you.
Thank you. We'll go for 1 minute to Ms. Ross Leighton, Chairman of the Subcommittee on Middle East and North Africa.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman, and I praise the courage, the strength, and the love that our witnesses have shown for their family members who are being used as pawns by the Iranian regime. Bob, Saeed, Amir, and Jason are American citizens being held in Iran, but they are much more than that. They are fathers and sons and husbands, brothers, uncles, and friends. Yet for years they have languished in Iran's most notorious prisons, and more needs to be done to secure their release now. The U.S. must not negotiate to reward the Iranian regime while continuing to pursue this weak nuclear deal with a regime that continues to imprison American citizens. We must make it clear in no uncertain terms that we will not allow the regime to hold American citizens and deny them their due process while torturing them and subjecting them to inhumane treatment. The administration must realize that while it expresses niceties to Iran, the Iranian regime continues to imprison American citizens and violate their human rights. This must stop now. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And lastly, 1 minute to Mr. Chris Smith, Chairman of the Subcommittee on Africa.
Thank you.
And Human Rights.
Very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for calling this extraordinarily important hearing, very timely. You know, I can only imagine the emotional agony, especially in the middle of the night, each of our distinguished witnesses experience as you pray, as you think of what and ponder what your loved one is going through. NAGMA is back again for the fourth time now testifying twice before my subcommittee. She has been absolutely tenacious on behalf of Saeed Abedini, as have all of the other witnesses, calling for their unconditional and immediate release. It seems to me to be folly in the extreme that we are engaging in a negotiation on nuclear, potential nuclear weapons when Americans are being held hostage by a dictatorship. I call again, as we all do, upon the administration to make this even more of a priority. Let's not forget, at the first hearing where Nagme testified, she had gone down to the State Department and they told her, there is nothing we can do. There is so much all of us can do. This resolution is another step in that direction, and hopefully we, in a totally bipartisan way, will express the will of the American people. Please let these innocent people go.
We need to welcome the newest member of our committee here, Congressman Daniel Donovan, Jr. He recently won the special election in Staten Island, New York. Previously, he served as district attorney in Richmond County. So welcome, Mr. Donovan. And you just, the family just had a baby girl, I'm told. Okay, well, congratulations, Mr. Donovan. And we now will introduce our panel, the witnesses here today. And Mr. Ali Rezaian is the brother of Washington Post correspondent Jason Rezaian, whose trial began in Iran last week in secret. And he has traveled, Mr. Rezaian has traveled from California to be with us today. We welcome him. Mrs. Nagma Abedini is the wife of Pastor Saeed Abedini, who is currently serving an 8-year sentence in an Iranian prison. Mrs. Abedini grew up in Boise, Idaho, and has been actively involved with her church congregation for many years. Sarah Hakmati is the sister of Amir Hakmati, a former Marine, now imprisoned in Iran for 4 years. Ms. Hakmati has led the campaign for his freedom since his imprisonment in 2011. And Mr. Daniel Levinson is the son of Robert Levinson, who has been missing in Iran since 2007. Mr. Levinson is an analyst at a government contractor, and he's based in Coral Springs, Florida, and we appreciate all of our witnesses being with us today. Without objection, all of the witnesses' full prepared statements are going to be part of the record, and members here will have 5 calendar days to submit any statements or questions or extraneous material for the record. And Mr. Rezaian, if we could start with you, if you could summarize your remarks, and thank you, sir.
Chairman Royce, Ranking Member Deutsch, and member of the committee, thank you for inviting me here today. My name is Ali Rezaian, and I'm here on behalf of my brother, Jason Rezaian, who's been held for nearly a year in a prison in Tehran for activities that he did not commit. My brother has always been a passionate storyteller. Since 2012, he has been serving as the Tehran bureau chief for the Washington Post. Jason's reporting in Iran has ranged from stories about everyday life in Tehran to baseball's growing popularity with Iranian citizens. His stories always went beyond stereotypes, reported on facts, and informed readers about the rich and complex fabric of Iranian society. While simply doing his job, Jason and his wife were taken without warning, and he has now been detained in Evin prison for 315 days. While most people know Jason as a journalist, I know Jason as a brother, son, husband, and devoted uncle. Jason is my little brother. In fact, when he was born, my parents turned to me for ideas about what to name him. I suggested the name Jason because at the time, my best friend's name was Jason. Today, Jason is my best friend. Like a lot of kids in our neighborhood, Jason grew up infatuated with Star Wars, and he always has been an enthusiastic Oakland A's fan. I proudly watched Jason grow up to be a truly, truly remarkable man. His intellect, endless curiosity, joy for life, and the ability to tell a story led him into journalism, where he has excelled. But above all, Jason is a loving family member. In 2011, my own family suffered the tragic and unexpected death of our 5-year-old son, Walker. Jason was working in Iran at the time when I called him with the news. Without a second thought, Jason got on a plane the same day to come to California to comfort and support our family. I cannot tell you how much that meant to myself, my wife, as well as our parents. In addition to being a devoted son and brother, Jason became a husband 2 years ago when he married Yegane Salahi. Sadly, Jason has now spent nearly half of their marriage in prison. My son Paxton, who is 7, asks me daily when his Uncle Jason is going to be released from prison. With the help of this committee and others from around the world, I believe Uncle Jason and Paxton can still see an A's game in Oakland together this summer. Let me be very clear. The charges against Jason are false. Jason did sometimes write about Iran's domestic and foreign policy, but this is perfectly legal conduct recognized around the world as practicing journalism. Iran's treatment of Jason has been and remains in violation of international human rights laws that Iran has repeatedly promised to uphold. Yet despite being party to treaties that protect free speech and due process, Iran has afforded Jason neither of these fundamental rights. Now more than ever, I am concerned about Jason's health and welfare. While in prison, Jason has suffered painful and debilitating infections. He has lost more than 40 pounds. He also has chronic high blood pressure and a respiratory condition that is exacerbated during the hot summer months in Tehran. He is often kept in solitary confinement and is allowed only minimal human interaction. I appreciate the support of all the very good people who want to free Jason. The Washington Post's chief foreign editor is here with us today. President Obama has spoken about Jason publicly. The Washington Post's legal team, led by Jay Kennedy, has been unwavering in its support of Jason and me. Thank you all. It means more than words can express. It's time for Jason to come home. It's time for the families here to all be reunited. Releasing Jason is the humane thing to do, and it's the right thing to do, and I hope that Iran will do so immediately. My mother wishes that she were here today to tell you all about Jason, but she's currently in Tehran so that she can more closely follow the situation with his trial. With the committee's indulgence, I would like to play a short video that perfectly sums up how we all feel.
Without objection.
I love my son and daughter, and I am proud of their commitment to journalism. I know their standards for truth and excellence in journalism guide them both professionally and personally. I humbly ask those who continue to detain my son and daughter to please release them and allow our family to be reunited and my fears for their safety to subside.
It's time for Jason to come home to his family. It's time for the loved ones of everyone on this panel to come home to their family. Iran could make that happen today and should do it without further delay. Thank you for your time, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Ali. Mrs. Avedini.
Thank you, Chairman Royce, Ranking Member Deutsch, and Engel, and members of the committee. And over 917,000 individuals who have signed petitions for the release of my husband, who've surrounded our family with their prayer and support. And I am thankful for State Department for speaking to Iran on the sidelines, and for the president who has spoken out and also gave me an opportunity for the kids and I to meet with them in January of this year. But as Mr. Rezaian mentioned, it's time to bring Saeed home. I've been before the Human Rights Committee and our Foreign Relations Committee a few times, and I just think about 3 years ago when I was so hopeful that maybe this hearing will bring him home, maybe this something will happen, and I'm really hoping that this will be it. I stand before you today, not as a lawyer or a politician. I'm actually very scared of speaking in public, but as a wife of a husband who's in prison in Iran because of his Christian faith. And the only reason I put myself out there and speak is to bring my husband home and to bring the father of my children home. Saeed is an American citizen who was sentenced to 8 years. As mentioned, the Iranian government has said they would add on more years because he refuses to deny his Christian faith. He's been in the Iranian prison for his Christian faith and for gathering with other believers 13 years earlier. Under a different president who was actually allowing it. And again, this is protected by Iranian law. But Iranian government has said that peaceful gathering of religious minorities as a threat to their national security. Every day I wake up with an excruciating pain, as I understand many of the families wake up. Life is no longer carefree. You wake up with a pain. Most mornings I wake up in a hotel room or I'm in airports, and I wake up to the reality of our life. My children have had to go without a father and a mother for 3 years now. It's very difficult to try to choose between being at home with my children when they need me the most and as they're hurting and they want to hold on to at least one parent, and trying to advocate for my husband. I can't imagine not doing everything I can every single day of my life until my husband's home. So it's very painful for me to have to leave my kids behind. I just came back a few days ago from speaking before the European Parliament and the German Parliament and trying to get their support. And my children, I had to explain to them why, again, I had to travel. And as they were desperately holding on to me and asking me not to go, and every time I tell them, it's for daddy, I'm gonna bring your daddy home. And I hope it's very difficult going back to them and not being able to have solid answers. I really hope that this will be the time that we can bring Saeed home. Saeed has been tortured. The first few months of his imprisonment, he was beaten pretty badly where his internal injuries and bleeding started. He has been exiled, sent to an exile prison, Rajai Shah prison. He's been moved many times. He was put in murder ward, where he was told by the head of the new prison that if they find out he's a convert, they will kill him. He was literally in the lion's den when he was in the murder ward in Rajai Shah, and he was covered with lice and doing horribly physically and psychologically. He has been put in and out of solitary 3 times now. The last time he was put in solitary was actually a few months ago when we made few days after we made that framework agreement with Iran. He was put in solitary again. I came to the United States 30 years ago, and the greatest gift that this country gave me was the freedom to choose Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. And for that, I'm forever grateful. And I felt safe. I felt I came to a safe place, a country that would protect me and would stand up for my freedom, for my especially religious freedom. And Saeed is in that situation right now. He refuses to deny his Christian faith, and the Iranian government continues to harass him and threaten him with more imprisonment. Have they put him in and out of solitary to break him? I'm not worried just about his physical pain, but his psychological. They're trying to... They want, when they release Saeed, they want to make sure they release a very sick person. And Saeed's held on to his faith and refused. But I'm very concerned. I think time is of the essence. I just want to finish with this verse, if I can, for a few minutes. I want to share, our family relied on the personal relationship. When you're going through a trial, no, the do's and don'ts of religion can't do anything for you. It's only a relationship with God through the price that Jesus Christ paid on the cross, that you can go through trials of life with peace and strength. No religion can give you that. It has to be a relationship with God. And this is, I believe this is where the blessing of this nation came from, and the freedom we have is because of the blessing that comes from our Lord Jesus Christ. Our family has relied on this personal relationship to endure this pain and to overcome our daily worries and concern. I want to conclude with the story in the Bible that describes our current situation. It includes a fiery furnace, threats of death, and a savior in the midst of it. It's the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And as you might know, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego refuse to deny, worship other gods, and they're told that they will be put in the fiery furnace, and they say, "Oh, king, we do not need to defend ourselves before you. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God whom we are able, who we serve, is able to serve us, but he will rescue us from your power. But even if he doesn't, we want to make it clear to you, your majesty, we will never serve your God." And this is our situation. Saeed refuses to recant his faith, and they command the furnace to be heated more, and in the end, the king says, "I see 4 men unbound walking in the fire." The 4th man was Jesus, and Jesus has been with us through this fiery furnace. It's been excruciating pain, and it's been difficult to even breathe most days, but I'm here to say that Jesus has been with us through every second of it with me and my family, and that invitation is open to anyone who wants to receive him. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mrs. Abedini. Sarah? Sarah, if you could hit the button there.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Can you hear me? Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member, and members of the committee, thank you for giving me the opportunity today to testify about the arbitrary imprisonment of my brother, Amir, and in support of Congressman Kildee's House Resolution 233, with your permission, I'd like the opportunity to submit additional material for the record. This is the first opportunity our family has received in nearly 4 years of my brother's imprisonment in Iran, and we appreciate the time and effort that went into making it possible for me to appear today on Amir's behalf. For over 3 years, our family's been living a nightmare. Every day we wake up hoping that it is the day we find out Amir will finally be released and is returning home. We are in constant fear for his health, his safety, and his life. The fact that Amir is the first American to be sentenced to death by Iran since 1979 adds to our fears. The fact that he has been held in Evin prison longer than any other American in history is emotionally draining. My parents came to this country not because they had to, but because they saw opportunities here that they wanted for their future children. My dad has a PhD in microbiology and was a college professor, and my mother an accountant. And it is in gratitude for the opportunities afforded to us as Americans that my brother Amir was proud to serve in the Marine Corps. I want to be very clear. While our family takes issue with the actions of a certain faction of the Iranian regime, we know this is not a reflection of the government as a whole, nor of its people. Iran is the country of my parents' birth, and as a family, we were always raised to be proud of our heritage. It is this pride in our heritage and importance of family that led Amir to make his first trip to Iran in August of 2011. It is a trip that thousands of Iranian Americans make. I myself have made this trip twice. Amir had last seen our grandmother when he was a young child in America. He felt it was his duty to visit her after all these years, elderly to come to the U.S. anymore. On August 29th, only days away from his return home to Michigan, Amir was preparing to attend a family gathering. However, Amir never showed up. When our family in Iran went to the cousin's apartment he was staying at, they could see the apartment had been broken into and a struggle had taken place. Amir was missing. Also were gone his computer, camera, and passport. Our relatives in Iran spent days contacting officials, searching Tehran for Amir, hoping to find out who took him, where they took him, and why. 2.5 months later, we found out that Amir had been imprisoned. At that time, both the Iranian and the U.S. government urged us not to go public with Amir's imprisonment, asking that his imprisonment not go public, and that it be handled behind the scenes. They both suggested that by going to the media, Amir would be put in more danger and his case would become highly politicized. Our family learned later that our silence allowed Amir to suffer the worst torture imaginable. As a sign of respect for both Iran and the U.S., Amir offered nothing but transparency when applying for a visa to Iran. He was assured that his past experience in the military would not be an issue. However, on December 2011, Iran reported that they had caught an American spy, and my brother's face appeared on Iranian state television. Our family received no warning of this by Iranian officials, and instead were faced with having to witness our brother be wrongfully accused before being allowed to defend himself in court. Days later, Amir was tried by Judge Salavati in the Revolutionary Court. He did not meet his court-appointed attorney until 5 minutes before his trial. Relatives were not allowed to attend his trial. It was held behind closed doors. And in only 15 minutes, Amir was charged with espionage, corrupting the earth, and waging war against God. By the end of the week, the media had announced, without prior notification to our family in the U.S., that Amir was sentenced to death. He became the first American to receive the death sentence since 1979. In March of 2012, however, an appeals court overturned the charges against Amir and annulled his death sentence, stating that there was insufficient evidence to let the conviction stand. A new trial took place in December of 2013. That was when we found out he had been sentenced to 10 years in prison for cooperating with a hostile government, presumably because of his military service to the U.S. The conviction of this crime confuses us. Based on the Supreme Leader's own mandate, service in a foreign military for a dual national is not illegal in Iran. Relations between the U.S. and Iran are at a historic point. Even according to Amir's Iranian attorney, how can the U.S. still be considered a hostile country to Iran when we sit across from them at the negotiating table for the first time in decades? Iran wants to rejoin the international community, expand their tourism industry, and help their economy grow. What message does it send to Iranians that live abroad when Amir is held as an innocent man behind the walls of Evin prison for committing no crime? As a tourist, Amir was kidnapped from the home of his relatives and taken to Evin prison. As a tourist, he was held in a 1-meter by 1-meter cell, allowed out for only 10 minutes a week to stretch his legs. He was beaten on his feet with cables, tasered repeatedly. He was held for months in solitary confinement. To date, our family feels as though we have exhausted every option. We have reached out to the UN, human rights groups, Islamic organizations, ambassadors from other nations, and we've engaged with high-level officials from the US and Iran. Our only reassurance is being told by the U.S. that Amir's case is being raised on the sidelines of the negotiations, and our reassurance from Iran is silence, only to be told that Amir is an Iranian and that his case will be dealt with according to Iranian law. We thank Congressman Kildee and Senator Stabenow for their efforts on our behalf, particularly arranging a meeting for our family with Vice President Biden last month. We are very grateful for his time and the compassion he showed my father and our children who are 5 and 7 years old. After our meeting, Vice President Biden tweeted about Amir. It was the first time some public mention had been made. Our family is under no illusion that there are things we cannot be told about the effort the government is undertaking on Amir's behalf, but it does not make sense to our family how previous American prisoners in Iran have been released when the United States had no diplomatic relations with Iran and were not sitting across the negotiating table much sooner than Amir. Now is the time that this issue could and should be resolved, and yet August will mark 4 years Amir has been taken from our family. And that brings me to my final point. Our father has terminal brain cancer. Within the last year, he has suffered several strokes, and our father now requires 24-hour care. My mother could not be with us today. She's with my father right now, and she misses her son very much. Our father holds on, hoping to hold Amir in his arms again, but fearful that he will not. And he now resides in a wheelchair, needing assistance for everyday things you and I take for granted. The father Amir left behind to visit his relatives in Iran is no longer the same man now. We ask you to please do all that you can to help fill this chair and bring Amir home. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. Daniel.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Daniel Levinson, and I'm the eldest son of Robert Levinson, who was taken hostage on the Iranian island of Kish on March 9, 2007. Unlike the other three Americans currently imprisoned in Iran, the government has never acknowledged arresting him. The closest evidence of this appeared less than 3 weeks after he went missing, when the Iranian state-sanctioned media outlet, Press TV, reported that he was, quote, in the hands of Iranian security forces and could be, quote, freed in a matter of days. 3,007 days later, we are still waiting for him to be released and returned home to us. My father is the longest held hostage in American history. No U.S. citizen has been held overseas longer than he has ever. Our family's hearts break for the other families here who have suffered the wrenching agony of having their loved ones away from them for so long, all of these years. Yet my father has been held 4.5 years longer than any of the others, and no family should ever have to go through what we are all going through. To say these past 8 years and 3 months have been a nightmare would be an understatement. I am one of my parents' 7 children, and my mother, who is here with us today, just marked their 41st wedding anniversary last month. My father has missed so many milestones, the births of 3 grandchildren, 2 weddings, numerous high school and college graduations. To put it simply, he has missed too much of our lives. There's not a day that goes by when we don't think of him, how much he must be suffering, and what we can do next to bring him home. In November 2010, we were emailed a one-minute video of my father from an anonymous email address where he looked gaunt, ill, and desperate. The last words we heard from him in that video were, 33 years of service to the United States deserve something. Please help me. 6 months later, we received several pictures from another anonymous email address where he held various signs in broken English that appeared to have been produced by his captors in order to taunt the United States government. We are extremely worried about his health. He is 67 years old with several pressing health concerns, including diabetes, hypertension, and gout. My father had a long career serving the United States. He was still a contractor for the U.S. government at the time of his capture, and therefore the U.S. has a moral obligation to help bring him home. We have sought help through numerous heads of state, presidents, prime ministers, foreign ministers, NGOs, private citizens, and religious leaders here and around the world to no avail. My mother, aunt, and I even traveled to Iran in 2007 to meet with officials there, but the trip ended with no progress made on his case. This has been a bipartisan effort, spanning two U.S. presidencies, with lawmakers from both parties working to bring him home. We are eternally grateful for the efforts of members of this committee, including Congressman Ted Deutsch, who represents our home district in Florida, and Congresswoman Ileana Ross-Leighton, who have continued their efforts to highlight my father's case in the House Foreign Affairs Subcommittee on the Middle East and North Africa. Senator Bill Nelson has been our staunch advocate and has given us a voice to the powerful. However, my father is still not here with us. We are encouraged by the election of Iranian President Hassan Rouhani and the appointment of Javad Zarif as foreign minister. They have sought active engagement with the United States on a number of issues, but to our knowledge, have not engaged on the topic of my father's capture in their country. My family believes this engagement is by far our best opportunity to bring my father home safely. And we need American officials to ramp up this engagement as they meet in the next few weeks over Iran's nuclear program. We implore negotiators to take a more aggressive approach than merely asking for Iran's help in locating him. It is true that those involved in the talks may not know where my father is or what happened to him, but we are certain that there are people in Iran who do. We believe that if the Iranian government had the will and motivation to locate my father and send him home, they most certainly could. My family will never rest until our father is back home with us, and we can only hope that the members of this committee, along with those involved in discussions with Iran, share that unwavering commitment. My father could be anyone's father, or grandfather, or brother, or husband. He is all of those things to my family. He is an American. And America should not rest until one of its own is returned home to the family that loves him more than life itself. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll go to Mrs. Abedini and Ms. Hekmati. Ms. Hekmati, for a question. I've read the reports on the torture in prison. What I am interested in right now is the mental well-being or the condition psychologically, if I could ask you about your husband and about your brother.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Actually, his mental condition is my biggest worry, even though his physical condition is not very well. He doesn't get very much protein or clean water, and he's still suffering from the internal injuries. But his mental is him being taken out in and out of solitary three times now, being put in exile prison, being put in murder ward, just the continuous pressure they've tried. He's seen in early April, there was close to 50 prisoners in his prison that were executed in Raja Ishar, and he's continuously told that he should be given the death. He should be because he's a convert, because he's a Christian. He's continually told he will never come out unless he denies his faith. And his family, his father, who's visiting him in Iran right now, is the greatest worry he has, is his mental condition and the psychological games they're playing with him. And my biggest worry as a wife and mother is the condition I will have to deal with when he comes home.
Thank you. Sarah?
Similar to Nagma, she referred to psychological games. Amir has been strung along for nearly 4 years. He said that during his court appearance for the 15 minutes that it was determined he was worthy of being sentenced to death, that his attorney had reassured him that he could be acquitted and be released in a year max. At that point, he was already serving 6 months. Now it's going on 4 years. He has been told things like his mother was killed in a car accident as a part of mental torture. At that time, he had no way of communicating to our family to even determine whether that was true or not. It's been a long ride for him to the point that he's become emotionally numb and just doesn't really know what to expect anymore. So we do really worry about his emotional well-being as well.
Last week, on the eve of the beginning of Jason's so-called trial, Washington Post editor Martin Barron issued a statement that read in part, "It is worth recalling what kind of system we're dealing with. Jason was arrested without charges. He was imprisoned in Iran's worst prison. He was placed in isolation for many months and denied medical care he needed. His case was assigned to a judge internationally notorious for human rights violations. He could not select the lawyer of his choosing. He was given only an hour and a half to meet with a lawyer approved by the court. No evidence has ever been produced by prosecutors or the court to support these absurd charges. The trial date was only disclosed to Jason's lawyer last week, and now, unsurprisingly, but unforgivably, it turns out the trial will be closed." Mr. Rezaian, have you been able to have any communication with your brother?
I haven't spoken to my brother since last July. My mother went to Iran and has been able to speak with him just recently. The trial did begin last week, and it adjourned after one day.
How are his spirits right now?
Well, I think that it's been very difficult for him to be so isolated. He's a very social person. I think that we're thankful that there is a process that's moving along, but as we can see, we don't know what'll come out of it. He's happy that my mother's there, although he's really concerned because neither his wife nor my mother were able to go to the trial when they started last week.
What would be the duration this charge brings with it? What consequence?
You know, we've heard different things, but I think that it could be, you know, years in prison is what we've heard. Possibly 10 years in prison or more.
Yeah. Were there any other thoughts that any of the witnesses would like to express at this time before I go to Mr. Engel? I thank you all for your testimony, and we'll now go to Mr. Elliot Engel of New York for his questions.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and I want to thank all four of you for the courage you have and for your extraordinary testimony. I want to tell you something you already know. I see Mr. Kildee is here. There isn't a moment that Mr. Kildee doesn't stop to talk to me about this case. He's been relentless. Mr. Deutsch as well. Mr. Huffman, I just want you to know that we are all with all of you. We cannot imagine the grief you're going through, and our hearts are with you. We'll do everything we can to bring them home, and that's why we're having this hearing, because we hope that at this crucial juncture, with less than a month to go before there is supposedly an agreement with Iran, this is the time to really bring forward the cases of your loved ones. This is the time. I must tell you that I feel so angry that at a time when we are sitting with Iran, and a number of you alluded to this, mentioned this in your testimony, we're sitting with them to discuss a new arrangement between our two countries, and they continue to poke us in the eye and continue to spit in our face. I don't know how else to say it. It's ludicrous, Mr. Rezaian, that your brother, at this juncture, when we're a month away from
perhaps having an agreement that they would dare to put someone on trial in a show trial, it just infuriates me. It just infuriates me. And while we don't want to tie your cases to our talks because we don't want Iran or others to bring in other issues, the fact of the matter is that it's just infuriating and outrageous that they would do this. They would just spit in our faces. So I just want to tell you that we are not letting any of these four cases drop. We are united in trying to help you. And I want to just thank you, all four of you, for your tremendous, tremendous courage. You know, if I let myself go, I would probably cry. That's how genuine all of you were and are. So thank you for your courage. Let me ask anyone who'd care to answer. We want to obviously do everything possible to help bring them home and create that kind of atmosphere. When we question the administrations, the presidents, people, when we are briefed, when we talk to them in private conversations, when we're briefed as a Congress, they tell us that they raise the issue of the American hostages each and every time they meet with the Iranians. Is there anything that you can tell us that has not been done that you would like to see us do or see the administration done? Is there anything more that we can do? I know having this hearing and us timing this hearing today is obviously something that we're attempting to draw attention to it. But is there something else that any of you think that we should be doing, perhaps? Ms. Hekmati.
Yeah, thank you for asking that question, because it's been our frustration, and it's not very comforting to know that at this point, in this juncture where we're at, that it's just being raised. And our question consistently when we ask what the substantial response is from the Iranians is nothing very substantial, other than in my case, for example, with Amir, that he's a dual national and they don't recognize his American citizenship. So I don't know how often, if this is being raised on a regular basis, are they just giving a flat response or no response, or what is the answer that they're receiving?
Thank you. I can tell you, for me, it would just be ludicrous and outrageous for us to have a deal with Iran that doesn't include the bringing home of our hostages. You know, we all remember, at least if you're as old as I am, 1979, when we had these American hostages being held for more than a year, and the whole country was riveted on it. And then finally they were brought home. Well, we want the country to be as riveted with your loved ones so that they can come home safely. So I just want to thank you all for your courage. And for me, you know, the devil is in the details. I'm going to see what the agreement is before I decide how I'm voting. But it would just be ludicrous for us to pretend it's business as usual. We're going to have a nice agreement with Iran. We're going to look to the future. We're going to have better relations, and we're all going to, you know, hold hands and skip away happily, and Americans are rotting in prison. That is not acceptable to me, and I hope it won't be acceptable to this Congress. Thank you for your courage.
Mr. Engel, if I could offer one addendum to that, I think it would also be important. I talked to a young Iranian who recently came to this country over the weekend, and she told me, I asked her about her experiences. She said her parents brought her here because she would start every morning, you know, with these chants in school, death to America, death to Israel. And she said this at home, and her parents said, you know, we're Jewish. We're concerned with the indoctrination. It's the indoctrination of children in Iran today, which produces the types of jailers that want to torture those of other faiths or want to torture Americans. And I think it would be important that Iran cease this kind of indoctrination of its children, stop the process of poisoning the minds of the next generation, because they're setting up a condition in which, when they become jailers or they become judges, they treat other human beings this way. Go to Eliana Ross Leighton from Florida.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for sharing your family's stories. I can't even begin to imagine the toll that this has taken on each and every one of you and your loved ones, but it's so important that you're here today and that you share the truth about what is going on in Iran inside this so-called moderate regime that we got with Rouhani. And it's no secret that the human rights situation in Iran under Rouhani, who was selected by the Supreme Leader, has actually gotten worse, and he continues to use your loved ones as pawns. The Iranian regime responds to strength, and they see us as weak right now, but our American citizens must not have a target on their back when they go to places like Iran and anywhere else because of this perception by the Iranian regime of us being weak. And your loved ones are American citizens. We demand their immediate, safe, and unconditional return now. I wanted to ask you about these nuclear talks. Do you worry that when the negotiations end, you know, with this deadline, but it will go on, do you worry that our leverage will not be there, or some of you believe that we should not be discussing your loved ones during these negotiations, that it's a separate item? So I wanted to ask your feelings about your thoughts about how the nuclear negotiations and these talks impact the imprisonment or the disappearance of your loved ones. Mr. Levinson.
Thank you. I appreciate that question because I think it's very important and relevant to the current situation. My family has always been supportive of engagement with the Iranians. We do worry that regardless of the outcome of the deal, if whether there is a successful deal and there's improved relations, I don't know if there will be the sense of urgency to get any of our family members home anymore. Because it would be a propaganda win for both for the regime and for us it would be I guess a win for the administration, but there's no urgency anymore to increase the pressure, and this is a very pressing issue that's lasted years for most of us. And I think if the talks fail and there is no deal, we could lose the engagement and the constructive talks that we're having right now, and those could cease, and then we're back to square one, particularly for my family as well.
So. Thank you very much, Mr. Levinson. Mrs. Abedini, I saw that you were agreeing.
Yes, I agree. I think this next few weeks is the very crucial time. If we don't get the Americans out, I don't know when we will have more leverage, and I agree with Mr. Levinson that either way we lose if we don't get the Americans out before an agreement is reached or not reached. We only have a few weeks left, and while we still have leverage, while the Iranian government would still be motivated at some degree to release them. And as I mentioned, they're not there, as the family members have said, they're being held on bogus charges. There's no evidence, they're being held because they're Americans or because of their freedom of practice, freedom of speech and religion. And so I think this is a very crucial time.
And I wanted to ask just one in the minute remaining, following up on Mr. Engel's question, what more can we do in Congress? What more can the administration do?
Well, thank you for the opportunity, and thank you for concern for everybody. I would, not being a diplomat or a policy expert, I would say that the things that you're doing right now, bringing attention to the case, showing unanimity, and the bipartisan support that we've seen for this type of activity is certainly very helpful.
Ms. Hibmati?
I was obviously, again, like Ali said, not from a policy expert, but maybe reaching out to bilateral governments that have a good relationship with the Iranians, because they tend to resist any kind of interaction from the U.S. or the Swiss, for example, that were the intermediary before. So perhaps reaching out to foreign officials as well.
Levinson?
I also agree that for us, the most important thing is to keep it in the eye of the administrations and the American public, because in this day and age, this is a great hearing, and it's going to generate news, and we need that. But in a few days, people may forget about it, and they will likely forget about it, and then we're back to where we were. And so seeing the U.S. Congress making this such a priority is crucial to all of us. And we have a limited window right now with the engagement going on, and if we can at least keep it up through that and past that until we're home, all of our family members are home, it would mean the world to all of us, I know.
Thank you. You are not alone. Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Ted Deutsch, a Florida ranking member on the Middle East Subcommittee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, first I want to thank all four of our witnesses for being here. I was reminded during your testimony of how much your four family members really reflect so much about what we value in our country. Obviously, the commitment to family that all four of you have expressed so powerfully. Mrs. Abedini, the role that faith plays for you and in our country. Ms. Hikmati, the story, the immigrant story that you described, your family coming, your parents coming to this country to provide opportunities for their children, which is really also so much the story of our country and the service to our country that Amir bravely served as a Marine. And Ali, freedom of speech and freedom of expression that we so often take for granted, it's impossible for us to do that as we listen to you talk about your brother. And as much as anything, we're a nation that perseveres. And Dan, for 8 years and 3 months that you and your mother and your siblings have endured, you have persevered, because 8 years and 3 months is just too long, and he has missed, as you said, too much of your lives. And so I would ask, you've all been told, we've been told that these talks on the sidelines, there is a focus on all four of your families. And you've answered what more should be done in our communication and with our government, other governments. I guess what I would ask you is to take advantage of this opportunity. If you were on the sidelines, if you were sitting with the Iranian foreign minister, what would you say? What would you tell them? Please, Ms. Abedini.
I would say no more discussions until first you release the Americans, then we'll talk further.
Mr. Rezaian?
I think I'd have to ask, what do they think they're accomplishing? You know, what are they doing to their own image if they want to join the community of nations, which is their stated goal, become more normalized? How do they think that this helps them at all?
Sigmati?
That's a tough question. I think just really trying to understand what leverage does these civilians who have no, clout or leverage in winning over any kind of concessions for Iranians with the United States, they need to be removed from this. So really just trying to understand what leverage they have.
Thanks, Dan.
Very tough question for us, because we're just desperate for anything, any kind of answers, any acknowledgement that he's there, anything that will provide us, give us hope. So that would be the first start. We've been reaching out for that for years, and we want anything. So,
Mr. Chairman, I would just finish by telling all of you, starting with you, Dan. We share your unwavering commitment to bring your family members home, and Ali, so that Jason and Paxton can see an A's game this year. Nagma, so that you can bring your children's daddy home. Sarah, so your father, especially, has an opportunity to embrace his son. And Dan, so at this point, so you and your mother, Christine, your entire family no longer have to celebrate family milestones without your father. I would finish just by telling again to all four of you that we'll continue to be your advocates, and bringing your family members home will continue to be a priority for Congress. We will continue to press to make sure that it's a priority for the administration. But I want to thank you for your willingness to come here today to testify, because I think, Dan, you're right. We have a short attention span in this country, but it's impossible to hear the four of you share in the most personal terms the impact of the fact that all four of you are missing your family members without being moved by it. And so I am sure that after today, the American people will continue to stand by you, as we will until your family members are brought home. We're so grateful for your participation. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Mr. Chris Smith of New Jersey.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And I, too, want to thank our very distinguished witnesses. Very powerful testimony on behalf of a son, a brother, sister, and, of course, husband. Hopefully the Iranians are listening. You know, they still are, or is still a country in relatively good standing at the United Nations, and I would be wondering if any of you would like to speak to how well or poorly the UN, the Human Rights Council, for example, Ban Ki-moon, has he raised each or any of your cases personally with Rouhani and other high officials in the Iranian government? You know, I met with Zarif some years ago on behalf of Saeed Abedini, and he commented to me and a few others who were in that meeting that this is different than Ahmadinejad's government, that Rouhani is different. And I said, if you want to really demonstrate that difference, the bold stroke is human rights. Start with the Americans, Mr. Levinson, who, you know, how many days? 3,000 days. It wasn't 3,000 then, but it certainly was thousands. Release the Americans, and we'll say a new page has been turned, and that Iran is on a different trajectory than it's been on in the past under Ahmadinejad. Sadly, and with great tragedy, it seems it has actually gotten worse when it comes to human rights, and the holding of four innocent Americans, the torture, the mistreatment, is absolutely appalling and brings dishonor to the country, or the government, not the country and not the people, but the government of Iran. And so I would tell you, your testimonies, by the grace of God, will be heard by the ears of the Iranian leadership and Zarif and others. I mean, Zarif was educated in Denver and in California. He knows Americans. He knows that human rights do matter, and he talks a good game. It's about time he showed it with his actions. So my comments to you, we will persist on. Mr. Levinson, you pointed out that we need to keep this in the eye of the administration. Hopefully they'll keep it in everybody else's eye. This is something that should be talked about, discussed, not on the fringes and on the sidelines of the negotiations, but as a mainstay issue. And whether the negotiations on nuclear issues succeed or fail, we will be there, I believe, as a Congress and hopefully the President, tenaciously pushing for the release until that happy day does arrive. Mrs. Abedini, you mentioned that you had been to the European Parliament and the Bundestag. You might want to elaborate on how well received you were there, because obviously the European countries are very involved with the nuclear talks, and they do care about human rights. And again, if any of you have any insights on whether or not the UN has been feckless and ineffective, or whether or not they have embraced each or any of your cases, your family cases, on behalf with the Iranian government. Ms. Abedini.
Thank you, Congressman Smith. The UN, I have spoken before the UN, and I know Ban Ki-moon has raised Saeed's case with the Iranian government. Recently, the working group of the United Nations released a report saying that Iran is breaking its own laws and international laws by holding Saeed in prison, and they should compensate every day of his imprisonment. So the UN has continuously spoken out about Saeed's imprisonment. Many countries at the UN have spoken out. My recent trip to the European Parliament was very helpful. One of the vice presidents took Saeed on as a political sponsor, and I was assured by many high officials at the European Parliament that Saeed's case would be raised, especially their foreign relations committees and their human rights committees were very involved. My trip to Germany and Berlin was very helpful. I met with Mr. Kauder, who's one level down from the Chancellor, and he was very helpful in making sure that Saeed's case is not only raised in the next few weeks during the talks, but also that Saeed's case is raised continuously with Iran as and their human rights issues is. I got to also meet with the head of the human rights group in all of Germany and also the Iran section, and it has been very helpful both with the European Parliament and the German Parliament working with their foreign relations and their religious freedom or their human rights groups. And it was very helpful. I received a lot of commitments and promises to advocate not only for Saeed, but also for religious freedom and human rights issues in Iran.
Thank you. I see I'm out of time. Hopefully the special rapporteur also raised it with the Iranians. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. Mr. Lowenthal? Yeah, Mr. Lowenthal is going to pass. Mr. Keating. Mr. Keating will pass. Mr. Kildee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And again, thank you for you and the ranking member for allowing me as a person who's not a member of the committee to participate in this important hearing. First of all, the committee will take up a resolution that will call for the immediate release of Amir Hikmati and the others. Amir is my constituent, somebody that I feel, though I've never met Amir, I have become very close with the Hikmati family, and I feel as though I know him. And if he's anything like you, Sarah, or your parents, it's no wonder that he's been able to sustain himself in nearly 4 years in one of the worst places on earth. The strength of will that you demonstrate obviously is something the other family members demonstrate, is something that your family members obviously share. We have over 160 members of Congress that have co-sponsored this resolution. And at a time, and we have to acknowledge this, at a time when there's very little agreement often on big questions that we're trying to wrestle with here in Congress, it's really important that this Congress speak with one unified voice on behalf of the millions and millions of people that we all represent, and make sure that Iran hears loud and clear that they cannot be accepted into the international community if they continue to hold innocent Americans who are guilty of nothing other than being Americans against their will for whatever political purposes they think they are achieving. And so I thank the chairman, the ranking member, for working with me to present this language to the committee, and I hope other members that have not yet signed on will do so, and that we can get a resolution to the floor as soon as possible. One other point that I would like to make, then I have a question or two. The P5 plus one negotiations, the nuclear negotiations with Iran, do provide something that we have not had in 35 years, and that is the opportunity for direct bilateral discussions between Iran and the United States. But I do think it's important, and I've heard loud and clear some of the comments made by other members, and I share the frustration, but I think it's really important that we make it clear that the onus is on Iran to release these Americans if they expect any negotiated agreement or any other engagement with the rest of the world to be taken seriously. And I say that to especially underscore the point that the freedom of Mr. Rezaian, Mr. Abedini, Amir Hikmati, Mr. Levinson, the freedom of these innocent Americans should not be exchanged for any concession regarding Iran's nuclear capabilities or any reduction and economic sanctions that have forced them to the table. Iran must act unilaterally if they expect any agreement or any engagement to be taken on face value. So that's, I think it's an important point, and it's important that we understand this moment provides us the chance to engage Iran on this question, but that we not conflate the freedom of these Americans with the items that are being negotiated regarding those nuclear capabilities. No American, and I know Amir feels this way, wants to be exchanged for something that we would grant to Iran regarding their ability to threaten the safety of the rest of the world. Iran must act unilaterally, and the U.S. must continue to press that point. And I think it's really an important distinction. For me, this is, many of the members know, this has sort of become personal. And I hope that that's the case for other members. I know it is for the other members that represent the families here. But I hope for all members, we look at this as a personal mission. I mean, these are American citizens. These are people who are part of us, and we need to do everything we can. And we need to press Iran and press our administration to be as strong as we possibly can. Sara, I wonder if you might talk to us a little bit about the contact that you, I know there's been occasional, not much occasional contact, but there was some discussion about how Amir is doing. Can you expand a bit on how he is doing physically and emotionally? I know the last few months especially have been particularly trying for Amir. If you could just tell a little bit more of his story in terms of how he's doing now, I think that would be helpful.
You know, it's a testament to Amir's character to note that Amir, when he learned that my father was diagnosed, it was late in the game. My father was already diagnosed with cancer and was undergoing treatment, and Amir had no idea. We did not have any contact with Amir for the first 2 years. No phone calls were allowed. We were not allowed to send letters. However, as of this past year, he's been allowed short phone calls. They are sanctioned phone calls. Obviously, my mother is the primary person that receives the phone calls, and he has his moments of hope when he hears that there's new developments in the political climate between the U.S. and Iran, and then sometimes that hope falls. Obviously, he's always cautiously optimistic, but holding his breath because he knows that he's been strung along for now going on 4 years. And, you know, it's just a testament to him, as much as this is really, you know, he's referred to his situation in some instances as he's died 100 times in this situation. So much so that he's become numb and just hardened himself to the fact that he doesn't know, like he has to kind of resign to, maybe he's stuck here for 10 years. He doesn't want to hold that in his mind. He wants to have hope. So we want to be able to give him hope, but it's almost psychological torture for our family to have his phone calls every day for 5 minutes and then to say what's new, and there's nothing new for us to give him. So it's been painful for him and for us as well.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Dana Rohrabacher of California.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and I thank the witnesses. I thank you personally, Mr. Chairman, and Ranking Member Elliot Engel for providing leadership in issues like this that you both continue to make us proud to serve on this committee. I was in the Reagan White House during the Iran-Contra fiasco, and it started with concern about hostages being held by radical Islamicists and a negotiation with the Mullah regime to try to get them free. That turned into an absolute fiasco. And we should have learned our lesson, and you do not negotiate with the Iranian Mullah regime as long as it is holding the hostages. And if you say, we will not be negotiating with you, that will give them some reason to actually let them go. The idea, I don't think that they pay any attention to the expressions of sympathy and solidarity that we have heard today. They don't care what we say here. They don't care what we think, as long as we don't have some action behind what we're talking about. Now, I support this resolution. I think it's a first good step, and I thank our leadership for bringing it forward and focusing the attention of this committee on this issue. I would hope that when we get done, however, that my colleagues would join me and our leadership would work with me on legislation that would suggest that if the Mullah regime continues to hold these hostages, and we consider it an illegal holding of hostages, that any representative of the Mullah regime that goes outside the borders of Iran would be susceptible of being taken into custody and held until the hostages are free. Maybe they would listen to that. Maybe they would be, if we arrested one of the leaders that is responsible for holding your families and held them, saying you are engaged in a blackmail, you are engaged in an activity that we consider to be illegal, then you will be held until those people are free, until your government has changed its policy. We have to do something like that, or they will not pay attention. And one last thing about the negotiations we have had. The fact is that the negotiations we've had with the Mullah regime, and thinking how important it is for this nuclear agreement, even though we realize if we make an agreement with them on this nuclear facility so that it can't produce the material for a nuclear weapon, even if we get that, they can buy a nuclear weapon. They can buy it. $25 million they can get in Pakistan or North Korea or whatever. But what these negotiations have done have prevented us from being tough on issues like this, where we should be tough, because it means something. And so I thank the chairman, I thank your witnesses for bringing this to our attention. I hope that we actually get together now, and now that the leadership has brought up the issue, put it on the table, I hope we come up with a solution that's going to get their attention and force decision-making by the Mullah regime. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you to the witnesses.
Thank you. We go now to Robin Kelly of Illinois.
I don't really have a question. I just want to thank you for coming here and sharing your stories with all of us. I really appreciate that, and I hope that something can be done where your relatives are freed, and I just want to thank Representative Kildee for his leadership in this effort. So thank you for being here.
Mr. Michael McCall of Texas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank the witnesses. I was a federal prosecutor for many years, and we have due process in this country. We have freedom of religion. And I look at these charges, and I mean, it's unreal. I mean, Ms. Abedini, your husband's crime was attending peaceful church gatherings for, as you put it, believing in Jesus Christ is a threat to the national security of the Iranian government. I just find that astounding. And for that belief, he is thrown into prison. What does that say about our negotiating partner? Are they really acting in good faith? And Ms. Hekmati, your brother, being put in a 1 meter by 1 meter cell and beaten and tortured, I can't imagine what he is going through. And I know you think about it every day of your life. And what is his crime? Corrupting the earth and being an enemy of God? Cooperating with the United States? I mean, what kind of charge is that? And now all the while we're doing these negotiations, it seems to me, Ms. Abedini, as you mentioned, now is the time to increase the pressure to release these American hostages. Now is the time we have the negotiations. And I would argue you're absolutely correct. We should halt these negotiations until these prisoners are released. We should stop the negotiation until they agree to release our American hostages first and foremost. But I am afraid that's not going to happen. I'm concerned also about what are we doing to facilitate the release of your loved ones. And we have witnesses come before this committee from the administration that talk about this issue, but we get very little information. I wanted to just each one of you tell me, what has the administration done to further the release of your loved one? And I'll start with Mr. Rezaian.
Well, I think I'm fortunate because it's possible that the administration learned some things from some of the previous situations. I've been in touch with the State Department. They have spoken with the Iranian government. They've worked with the Swiss Protecting Power as well, although the Iranians won't give Jason access to the consular access. So those kinds of things. And they've been in touch with me on numerous occasions. When I have questions, I'm able to contact them.
Ms. Albedini?
I've been in contact with the State Department regularly. They share with me that, as Ms. Hikmati mentioned, that they're being discussed on the sidelines, and the Iranians are not really responding to that. And they're if we continue this talking for the last almost three years of talking on the sidelines, it's not really working. They're not released. It's been almost 3 years for our family. In a few weeks, it will be 3 years since we've seen Saeed. My frustration is, I appreciate that they're being discussed on the sidelines, but they're still not home. Where's the action? Where's the results? I don't see any result. Iran continues to shrug it off and not really respond to our discussions on the sidelines. And as I mentioned, this is crucial time. Iran has to feel some pressure to want to release the Americans. They're not going to do it through sideline discussions and chit-chatting. And I hope there's some pressure to as this is a crucial time to bring these Americans home and end our pain and suffering of all of our families. And even one day, we would appreciate it.
I mean, American hostages should be the priority, not be placed on the sidelines.
Exactly.
Ms. Hikmati.
Right, just to chime in with the rest, it's pretty much been a lot of our family informing them of what's been going on in the process in Iran, and then being reassured that it's a priority and that it's been raised. And obviously they've done some facilitating of engagement with governments that have a bilateral relationship with the U.S. and Iran, and reaching out to them, and they've reassured us that they have these nations. Whenever there's an opportunity to engage with the Iranians, that they reach out and they ask about the cases of the prisoners being held there. However, again, I reiterate, this is that prior to us even having this face-to-face engagement, these prisoners that were American that have been released have never been held as long as, for example, Amir, and he's going on 4 years where we're sitting face-to-face. So I'm wondering, how effective is this raising of it on the sidelines of these negotiations really at this point? And I think that we're beyond that.
I see my time has expired. Mr. Levinson, just very quickly.
I'm afraid we're in the same boat, because right now it has been on the sidelines, but for years we didn't have any kind of engagement, so this has been a progress. But my father's a retired FBI agent, so we've been working very closely with the FBI, but they have limited powers and what they can do. I just want to note real quick, in case there are people watching this online in Iran, the FBI has offered a $5 million reward for the safe return of my father. So we'd like that to be highlighted as well.
That's a good point. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. We go now to Mr. Matt Salmon, Chairman of the Asia Subcommittee.
Thanks a lot. First of all, Ms. Hikmati, I just wanted to acknowledge the fact that your brother was born in Arizona, in Flagstaff, where I'm from, and a lot of prayers and thoughts are coming from Arizona. The other thing I wanted to comment on is that I think you have one of the greatest advocates in the universe helping you with Montel Williams. He is a great guy. Never seen a Marine in trouble that he didn't step forward to bail out. Worked with him on Andrew Tamarisi, and I just think the world of Montel Williams. He's an American hero. You got the right guy helping you out.
We were all born in Flagstaff, so.
That's great. we love Flagstaff.
We do too.
Ms. Albedini, I just wanted to make a comment to you how moving your testimony of Jesus Christ was to me personally. You know, in some of my darkest hours in my life, when I thought that there was nobody for me, he was. When I was a young missionary for the Mormon Church in Taiwan, I had some cards printed up that a true friend is one that walks in when the rest of the world walks out. What I've found in my life is he always walks in. I was very, very moved by your testimony. And I wanted you to know that I truly do believe also he won't let you down. We do hold the cards, folks. We do hold the cards. We just voted a few weeks ago to require a vote by the Congress on any deal that the Obama administration strikes with Iran. And I think we should state unequivocally, both from the House and the Senate, that any deal with Iran is dead on arrival that doesn't include the release of these prisoners. That's what we should say. And we should do it either through a joint letter of members of Congress, a number of us from the House and the Senate side. I think if we can achieve a critical mass saying that any deal is dead on arrival that doesn't deal with this prisoner release. And I think that we say that. I know right now it seems like the president wants a deal more than life itself on this nuclear thing, which I'm very, very skeptical about to begin with. But it seems like that ought to be the one fundamental thing that we can all agree on, that if it doesn't include that, it's done. Mr. Rezaian, I'm curious about the charges of your brother. Do you have any idea how the Iranian government became aware of both your brother's American visa application submitted to the U.S. consulate in Dubai and the letter that he wrote to the Obama administration as part of a job application? Has there been any investigation how they were able to attain that information that they're using as evidence against your brother?
Our assumption is it came from his computer. When they came, they took his computers, phones, all those kinds of things. So we believe that that's where it came from.
You know, I learned early in my youth, when I was a little boy, I got picked on by a bully in the schoolyard, and the only thing that bullies understand is a punch in the nose. And I think that's how we have to deal with Iran. Look, on this deal that they're talking about, the president is negotiating, it means billions and billions and billions of dollars to these guys. The very least we can do is step forward and say any deal is dead without the release of these prisoners, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Chair recognizes Mr. Duncan from South Carolina.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm sorry. I'm sorry the United States government has failed you and your families. These prisoners are American citizens, and that should mean something. It does to the men and women in this room, and the United States Congress, the 160-plus people that have signed this resolution, the 90 people in the Senate that voted for a similar resolution. You know, I think about the fact that more attention was given to the Natalie Holloway disappearance in Aruba 10 years ago than has been given to your loved ones imprisoned in Iran. I want to take this moment to thank those that are around the world that are praying for you and your families. I join them in those prayers and ask that God will keep you from having that pain every morning that you talked about, Ms. Abedini. That God will comfort them wherever they may be, whatever jail cell or situation that they're facing today. That they will understand that there are folks here in the United States that love them and care for them and are doing everything we can to affect their release. I agree with Mr. Kildee when he said that there shouldn't be any quid pro quo here with negotiations with Iran over their nuclear weapon. That's an issue that America doesn't want to see in the Western world, and the free world doesn't want to see Iran have a nuclear weapon. But if Iran wants to enter the international community and be taken seriously, they need to release these prisoners that were taken forcefully from an apartment of their loved ones. These are American citizens.
We've seen the United States Senate pass by a vote of 90-0 a non-binding resolution stating that the United States government should undertake every effort using every diplomatic tool at its disposal to secure their immediate release. We're getting ready to pass the same thing by a vote in this committee. I look forward to the opportunity to talking about your loved ones from the floor of the United States House of Representatives, continuing to raise awareness. But this is a resolution. What can we do? You heard a gentleman from Arizona, Mr. Salmon, talk about we have tools at our disposal, pieces of legislation that give the United States government leverage over this regime, leverage with more sanctions. We shouldn't be lifting any sanctions until these prisoners are released, because these prisoners are American citizens, and that's what America is about. Congress still retains that ability. Do you believe that further legislative action is necessary? What more can we be doing? And I'm going to ask each one of you, what more can we be doing? Mr. Rezaian.
Well, thank you. As I said before, I'm not a policy expert. You guys are the policy experts. I'm in favor of any kind of activity from you guys. From the Congress, from the President and the State Department, that would get Jason out as soon as possible. I'll leave it up to the experts to decide.
Ms. Abbott, any?
I would say help bring my husband home before you consent to any deal. When you're reviewing the deal, consider whether they're home or not.
Okay.
Thank you.
I want to ask you real quick. You said you were in communication with the State Department. Do they call you or do you call them?
They call me both when I have updates. I contact them, but they contact me regularly. It's been very good communication, especially the last year, where they're, you know, again, it's always discussed on the sidelines, and Iran continues not to respond.
Right. Well, that's good to hear that they call you and you're not in the dark. Yes. I appreciate that. Ms. Hekmati, about what more can we be doing?
I mean, obviously, in my limited knowledge of what you can do, I just think continuing to keep this in the forefront of this administration's, especially when Secretary Kerry is engaged with them, and what is the response, and continuing to push and understanding what it's going to take to bring them home. I just don't want this to be forgotten. I know when the hostages were taken in 79, this was something we as a family have a countdown of how many days he's been in prison. And I think that countdown needs to exist for all of the prisoners, and it needs to be visible.
Thank you. Mr. Levinson.
As I mentioned, keeping in the headlines is ultimately most important, and we're just ordinary Americans, and we're doing our very best, but you guys are the ones who can make the headlines. And I know in a couple of days, if God willing, they get home in the next couple of days, but it's very unlikely that will happen in the next couple of days. When you get home and you see that it's out of the headlines, think about what can you do to keep this in the public eye? What can you do to keep the pressure up on our government to make sure it's not forgotten? Because I'll go home and I'll think about my dad all day, every day, and Americans won't be doing that in a couple of days. And can you remember our family members who are suffering over there and think about where they're doing, when you're brushing your teeth, when you're at home with your kids, thinking about what they're missing out on, and that if you guys have any power to remind everybody in the world what's going on, please use any tools at your disposal.
And it happens, and y'all, please know, your loved ones have not been forgotten. Every day, the floor of the United States House, someone goes to the floor with a one-minute speech to remind Americans. And I want to thank the gentleman sitting behind you, Montel, for staying engaged in this. As I talked about, Natalie Holloway's case, you know, 10 years ago had all this national attention. Where is the national attention for their loved ones that are imprisoned in Iran? Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the leniency. I yield back.
Thank you. We go now to Mr. Randy Weber of Texas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank you all for being here today. And I have some real quick questions. Rezaian. When's the last time you spoke with your brother?
We spoke in July, about 3 days before he was taken. He was planning to come on vacation to the U.S.
Okay. Ms. Abedini, when's the last time you spoke with your husband?
The Iranian government hasn't allowed any calls. His father visits him in prison every Wednesday.
But when's the last time you personally spoke with your husband?
There was a, before his sentence in January of 2013, there was a sanction call for a few minutes, for probably about four or five minutes.
So about 2 years and 4 months ago, give or take.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Ms. Hekmati, when's the last time you spoke with your brother?
Me personally, a week ago for 5 minutes. And again, I noted that he's been able to call almost daily for about 5 minutes.
And Mr. Levinson, your dad?
March 8th, 2007, 3,008 days ago.
Over 8 years ago.
Over, yeah.
I hope the administration is paying attention. Y'all are real people with real lives in real pain. This is really bad, real serious. None of us wanted this. I don't feel like we started this. This regime, and I'll call them a thuggish regime, has started holding hostages in 79. And for the administration to be negotiating with these thugs, in my estimation, is just real foolishness. And I think, and I appreciate my brother Duncan's comments over here, that somebody goes to the floor of the House daily with a 1 minute to remind the American people how really bad this is. I appreciate his comments. I think Congress should get real serious, no agreement, period, until Iran releases the hostages. They want to reenter the world community. We keep hearing they want to reenter the world community. Well, if they want to do that, then they need to get real serious right now. I just hope that John Kerry, President Obama, and everybody on their team that's in the negotiation phase would, quite frankly, come to their senses and say, if human rights isn't everything, isn't the main thing when you're dealing with this kind of regime, how can you trust them on anything else? And so I just hope and pray that our president and John Kerry wakes up and understands the dilemma that's before us today and how long it's been going on. Mr. Levinson, 3,000 days?
3,007.
This is unconscionable that we would be dealing with a regime like that. And if this hearing, if nothing else, if y'all being willing to come out and through your pain, share with us so that we can get some attention. If our president and our secretary of state would pay attention and make this an issue, then we might be able to help bring your loved ones home. And I pray real soon. And Mr. Chairman, I'm going to yield back before my time. Thank you.
Mr. Darrell Issa of California.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank our witnesses for being here today. Usually when we have witnesses, their testimony is a series of complex facts. Today, very clearly, your facts are pretty simple. We have a rogue nation. It has been a rogue nation since 1979 when it took our embassy in violation of all sensibilities in the global community. Held them pointing fingers at students when in fact it was the new government that took those hostages, those diplomats, many of them covered by international diplomatic immunity. Your loved ones are not covered by diplomatic immunity, but they should be covered by the sensibility of fair and honest trials, and they are not. So you have this committee, I think, on an incredibly bipartisan basis support that we will, in fact, continue to use such power as we have, including resolutions and opposing the president's normalizing of relations with Iran in any way, as long as not just they do or don't have nuclear ambitions, but they do or don't respect the rules of the civilized community. And whether that's unlawfully keeping your loved ones in various levels of detention, support for Hezbollah and Hamas, the various global terrorism they've supported, or in fact, their continued attempt to destabilize country after country throughout the Muslim world. So like many of the members here, there aren't a lot more questions to be asked of you. You've done a great job of explaining the plight of your loved ones. I do very much support the chairman's effort to make it very clear that Iran has to change its ways in three ways: abandon its nuclear desires, treat both their own citizens and their visitors with a level of respect and rule of law that they clearly do not at this time, and stop their attempt to destabilize countries within the world, but particularly within their region. And so, Mr. Chairman, I too will be yielding back, but I would ask if any of the witnesses wanted to add anything from their observations to things that we should be aware of in our deliberation here relative to Iran. Okay. Again, thank you, and I yield back.
We go to Mr. Meadows of North Carolina.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank each of you for being here today and sharing your personal story. Mr. Levinson, today is the first day that I've met you, but I feel like I've known your family because Mr. Deutsch is on each and every hearing. He hasn't missed one, has raised this particular issue with the Secretary of State, Mr. Kerry, sitting at that same table. He has done that. So I feel like I know your family. I had to Google it the first time that he mentioned it, and shame on me for that. For many of you, this is the first time I've met you, but Miss Abedini, it's not the first time for us, and I just need to ask your forgiveness, because we have been working very hard to get your husband, who is a U.S. citizen, and his only crime was that he cared about other people. And this goes back many, many, many months. We met in New York. I met at that particular time with Foreign Minister Zarif personally and raised this issue. We've had conversations. We've had hearings. We've talked to the State Department. And each and every time we've wanted to make sure that we did no harm, that we were gentle in our negotiations to make sure that we didn't create a worse situation for your family members. I've run out of patience. The time is now. The time must be now. And we've heard these words from Mr. Kildee, who is advocating on behalf of a constituent. This is a bipartisan issue. It is not Republican or Democrat. We have come together. But we've failed, many of you. And what I want to make sure that is clear, the message to Iran today, is in the late 70s, there were thugs and terrorists that took hostages. And they wore ski masks and dark clothing. And that the only difference today is that the terrorists and thugs wear suits and give the illusion of being international diplomats. And that is not the case. And so you have my commitment that I won't vote for a deal. I will advocate tirelessly with my colleagues on both sides of the aisles to make sure that no deal is signed until your family members come home. And it is a precondition of what we must do. It is not a sidebar. It is not a note that we are doing soft diplomacy. It is time for real, hard facts, and it is time that we demand that U.S. citizens return home to their family. So you have my apologies for not being effective. I pray that there are no more birthdays, anniversaries, or holidays that are missed until they come home. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Mr. Lee Zeldin of New York.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And as I listen to Mr. Meadows, we're all reminded of the passion and emotion investment that so many of my colleagues have towards this effort. I'm honored to serve with them at moments like now. where you see that kind of passion on both sides of the aisle, both Republicans and Democrats from all across America who want to be part of the successful effort to bring back your loved ones. I also very much appreciate the fact that you've gotten individuals with followings from around America to take up this cause, to raise awareness, because I think that's a key part of this effort, is to raise awareness as to what's going on. It's hard to work your way through Twitter without coming across a hashtag Free Amir Now. I know that people like Montel Williams going on national TV to help the cause. I personally don't believe the negotiations should have started without freeing your loved ones. The President of the United States believes in making good faith concessions when he starts negotiations with other countries. The President of the United States made a slew of dozens of concessions before starting a negotiation with Cuba. Right now, our leverage is being negotiated away at the table, and I'm concerned with everything that isn't part of the negotiation right now, including returning your loved ones back to your homes so you can be able to start enjoying holidays together again. The President of the United States has this burden on him, and I would greatly encourage him in his foreign policy approaching his last year and a half in office as he's negotiating with Iran to not only avoid negotiating away his leverage and his diplomats' leverage to bring your loved ones home, but not to undercut and handicap whoever the next president of the United States is. Because if this president isn't getting the job done, the next one's going to be faced with that burden, and I want to do everything in my power because this cause really shouldn't outlast this presidency, but there will be challenges that the next president will be inheriting. So my personal opinion is these negotiations shouldn't have started without that good faith concession being made from Iran. I'd like to also say thank you to Congressman Kildee, Congressman Deutsch, for their leadership on this effort. As I've mentioned at a past hearing, I have more members and family members in Congressman Deutsch's district than my own down in Florida. I'm Jewish. The pilgrimage for New York Jewish families to make the trip to Boca, that's going back to the homeland for us. But you know, we're all uniting for a very worthy cause that hopefully we can come back here and have something great to celebrate. But the very real threat of negotiating away that leverage for this president's, our diplomats, or the next is something that we need to take very seriously. Because if Iran doesn't have the incentive now when they're pursuing that $50 billion signing bonus, or the $140+ billion that's following right behind it, as they are working to overthrow foreign governments, sponsoring terrorism, pledging, the chanting death to America, developing ICBMs, but there is no conversation that can be complete without talking about what's not part of the negotiation, without talking about the United States citizens being unjustly imprisoned by the Iranian government and those who love America. And that's a cause worth fighting for with as much passion and conviction as we saw Mr. Meadows have just now. And thank you for your efforts, and thank you for all of your supporters for helping advance the cause. I yield back the balance of my time.
Mr. Donovan of New York.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just had two quick questions. As you heard when I was first introduced about 2 hours ago, this is my very first hearing, and I just had a baby. And I think about, if someone had ever taken my baby, she's only 14 days old, what I would do to get her back. And I think about your loved ones, and your loved ones are Americans' children, America's children. We should do everything in our power to get your loved ones back. I just had two quick questions. I thought, Ms. Hekmati, that you had told us that you're informing the State Department of the progress with your brother's captivity, that it's not the other way around. Do each of you have someone from the State Department who's your liaison that you could call any time, day or night, to find out the status of your loved one? Do each of you have someone that you could do that with? And my other question was, the four of you come here, your tenacity to fight for the freedom of your loved ones is unequivocal. Are there other families that you're aware of that aren't here who are suffering the same fate as you are? Are there other families that you're aware of who have loved ones who are being held captive that you're aware of?
Many Christians, unfortunately, are being held captive or imprisoned in Iran. So I know a lot of families that are imprisoned simply because they're Christians.
American families?
Not American, but Christian.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back my time.
Any other members seeking recognition? Well, this then would conclude our hearing. Again, we want to thank the witnesses. We deeply appreciate you coming to Washington to testify today, and we will be in contact with the family members as we continue our efforts. We deeply appreciate your courage, and we are very, very sorry for what each of your families have been through. So at this point, though, we have to conclude this hearing, and we will now go to the markup on the resolution. If you would like to stay for that markup, we appreciate also your support for the resolution by Mr. Kildee, which we're about to bring before the committee. So we stand adjourned for the hearing, and I'm going to ask that the committee to come to order and members to return here to the committee for the markup. We meet pursuant to notice to mark up a single resolution. The clerk will take her seat. I now call up House Resolution 233, expressing the sense of the House of Representatives that Iran should immediately release the three United States citizens it holds, as well as provide all known information on any U.S. citizens who have disappeared within its borders. Without objection, the resolution is considered read and open for amendment at any point. All members may have 5 days to submit any questions or extraneous material for the record. After opening remarks from myself and the ranking member, I'll be glad to recognize any others seeking recognition, and I'll yield myself right now such time as I may consume. I again want to thank the family members who testified at this morning's hearings. I also want to thank the author of this measure, Congressman Kildee of Michigan, as well as those members who continue to stress how important it is to this body and to the American people that these Americans come home. I am a proud co-sponsor of this resolution, as are many members on this committee, and this resolution rightly points out that if Iran truly wishes to engage constructively with the rest of the world, step one would be releasing these Americans and allowing them to be reunited with their loved ones. Last month, the Senate passed a similar resolution by a vote of 90-0, and I look forward to the House taking up this measure with a similar show of unanimous support. And I now recognize the ranking member, Mr. Engel, for his remarks.
Mr. Chairman, thank you for bringing forward this resolution, which of course I support, and thanks to the members of Congress, in particular Mr. Kildee, who, as I said before, has been relentless in this. Talking to me all the time about this, and won't rest until the hostages are all free. So thank you, Mr. Kildee, for all your hard work. I want to also thank Mr. Deutsch, Mr. Labrador, Mr. Huffman, along with Mr. Kildee, who represent the families of the detained and missing Americans in Iran, for their leadership in pressing this issue and ensuring that these Americans are not forgotten, will never be forgotten until we get them home. I want to thank all witnesses for joining us earlier today. These men and women come from different walks of life, but what they share is the daily uncertainty about family members, all American citizens, and we should stress that. This is about all American citizens missing or detained in Iran. I wish we knew more about the conditions of these four Americans, but in these cases, Iran, as usual, isn't playing by the rules. I can't say that's a huge surprise. Mr. Chairman, typically if an American were detained in Iran, our Swiss interlocutors would have access to them for consular services. In the cases of three Iranian Americans, Iran doesn't acknowledge their dual citizenship, only their Iranian citizenship. This position runs roughshod over long-established international law. Without consular access, we can't judge the health and welfare of our own people. The United States respects this access for Iranian citizens held here, reciprocal privileges of the least they could provide. Sadly, Robert Levinson's whereabouts are unknown, as we heard in the testimony. I simply don't believe that the Iranians have been forthcoming about his status. If he is indeed a hostage, he is now the longest held hostage in American history. Some argue that we should tie Iranian cooperation on this matter to the outcome of the nuclear talks. I feel that way very often. It's absolutely ludicrous that we're negotiating with a government that is holding our citizens to languish in Iranian jails. We remain deeply concerned about Iran's imprisonment of Americans and the lack of information about the whereabouts of Robert Levinson. This is a bipartisan concern. It doesn't matter where you come from in this country or what your political affiliation is. We want to see all the hostages home safely to their families. I think it's clear from the emotional testimony we've heard here today that when it comes to these missing and detained Americans, Iran can do much more to help bring these Americans home to their families. So I'm glad we're doing this hearing. Mr. Chairman, I thank you for doing this hearing. This has been a great, once again, bipartisan collaboration on the part of the Foreign Affairs Committee. And again, I want to thank our colleagues, particularly Mr. Kildee, for coming here and working with us in partnership. And we're not going to stop till we get these people home. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Engel. Do any other committee members seek recognition to speak on this measure? If are there any amendments? Hearing no further requests from members, the chair now moves that the committee agree to House Resolution 233. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed, no. In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it, and the resolution is agreed to. And without objection, the measure is ordered favorably reported, and the chair is authorized to seek consideration under suspension of the rules. Thank you, members, and we now stand adjourned.